trying to I at least get a review. Hi, Angel. Of the thing. What we're talking about, going to talk about first is the volcanoes. That he's got two active volcanoes and one extinct volcano. And then he has the rose, and so it forms like a mandala, you know. And then we're going to talk about the six planets that he visits on the way back, which is very similar to this adventure in Mysterium Conjunctionis of Hermes ascending and descending through the planets. And then we're going to talk about the snake, and the snake takes up the whole rest of the today. We're not going to talk about the fact that the rose was not unique, you know. That'll come next time. It's pretty important that the uniqueness of our existence, you know, and how we can't be lumped in with anything. Hi, Tim. Hi, Elizabeth. Hi.
Happy Easter, everybody.
Well, happy Easter. Yeah, I wasn't sure how many people would be here for Easter. We did our Easter egg hunt yesterday, but you know, everybody's gone now. So anyway, hi, Elizabeth. If you have Elizabeth, if you haven't been here before, you can put your email in the chat, and we can get you on the mailing list too. So anyway, what we're talking about here in lecture four, we're going to talk about probably three quarters of it, and the last little bit we'll save till next time. But first we're going to talk about the volcanoes, then we're going to talk about the six planets, then we're going to talk about the snake for the rest of the time. And it's very important because the snake represents both life and death. And in Exupery's case, well, let's talk about the volcanoes, because there's something interesting about life and death in the volcanoes. There are three volcanoes on his planet, two active, one extinct. And every morning, the little prince cleans the extinct one, because one never knows. You know? And then, you know, you could say that about Yellowstone, you know, the big volcano there hasn't erupted for 600,000 years, but one never knows. You know, in the picture, he's cleaning one, has a pan with handle on the other. And let's see, I do have a picture of that. Let's see. Yeah, here it is. There. Okay. So he's got the one he's cooking on, the one is he's cleaning, and then the extinct one, even though it looks like it's smoking, has a cap on it, and then there's the rose. So it really forms a mandala. Let's see, four. Oh, just have to keep my... There, good. So the volcano is representative of hi, Miles. Just got started. The volcano is a representative of one who is inclined to emotional eruptions. You know, he's cleaning his volcanoes. Hot temper, lots of emotion, bursts out at any time. But now, if there's an extinct volcano, what does that mean? So when a volcano becomes extinct, crust on crust is formed within it, so that fiery core of the earth is covered over with material, and actually it doesn't burst out in the same way. You know, I don't know if any of you have ever been to Devil's Tower, but that's what is left over from an extinct volcano. You know, it is, you just Google it. It's amazing. So an extinct volcano does not mean that you've overcome your emotions, but it means the possibility of expression has ended. And there, the fire is closed up, so the central fire of the asteroid has faded out in that particular corner. So it's a catastrophic picture. Libido has gone. There's no way for energy to come out, not even by a negative eruption. So this is talking about Exupéry and his weak point too, the fact that he doesn't have much earth. So if the volcano dies, that means the central fire was slowly burning down and fading away. And so it's earth in the process of dying or getting colder. This inner process of transformation of the material within slows down and becomes less intense. So we have to look at it in conjunction with the small size of the planet that he's living on. The smallness of the earth on which the elephants cannot stand. His elephants are his genius and his great abilities. He does not have enough psychological substance to support his incredible personality and mind. So it's again a hint of vital weakness, of a vitality which is giving out in some corner. And it's the capacity for a direct emotional reaction. This is gone. The image of an extinct volcano often appears in analysis. It illustrates what we might call a post-psychotic state. People in psychosis have tremendous emotional explosions, but after which comes the regressive restoration of the persona. In other words, after, let's say, the day after Armageddon, you know, you still gotta, you know, have breakfast and stuff. So, you know, you have to, it's sort of this great anticlimax. And such people are literally comparable to a burnt out volcano. They seem reasonable, adapted, back in life, but they don't have any fire. Something has burnt out by the previous destructive explosion. And she says, if you treat post-psychotics, you notice that when certain really important problems are touched upon, there's no reaction. Usually if one gets close to a normal person's essential issue, essential problem, things really get hot and they get excited and nervous. They begin to lie. They begin to blush. They become aggressive in analysis. You know, so Arpanae is here. Okay, so hi Arpanae, we're just talking about the volcanoes and in the extinct volcano and the fact that somebody is it's like after a any climactic event, things go back to normal and they don't ever repeat that crescendo of emotion that happened before. You know, the Kama Mara, the one that tempted the Buddha, you know, had three beautiful daughters and their names were desire, fulfillment, and regret, you know. So when we're talking about the extinct volcano, we're talking about his third daughter, you know, the one who represents, you know, the fact that all of this emotion, then we had to return back into our wet bathing suit, put it that way, you know. He says, when there is this, when you expect there to be this big eruption where people get excited, nervous, start to lie in analysis, blush, or become aggressive, with the post-psychotic, it's just not so. things should get really hot, and they're just as a very matter of fact. Yeah, I know. You know, so there's no reaction exactly when it might be expected to be extremely painful. And so it's expressed by the symbol of the burnt out volcano, which is the one with the cap on it in the picture. So, and dreams show the burnt out volcano, and they're symbolic of the post-destructive condition. So now what is his destructive condition? We'll find out in a second here. On a minor scale, one experiences the same thing after expressing a strong effect. Everyone has experienced that awful come down after we let off a very strong effect of either love, anger, or whatever. It's followed by fatigue and indifference. So all reaction that we had has been exhausted, and one is burnt out. And here the destruction, here in Exupery, his destruction is only partial, for only one of the four things, the two active volcanoes and the rose and the extinct volcano, is extinct. You know, so it means that one function of his four functions has given out. So the flower would stand for feeling, in which case the opposite would be thinking, where the volcano is biggest and well drawn. And that is the one he's attending. So these actually represent Exupery's functions. And from his, we have to find which one of the functions is burnt out. So his inferior function is feeling, but he has one that's burnt out, and that's sensation. That's his touch with reality. So that's the one with the cap on it. So that would mean the other one with the pot on it is intuition. But he doesn't, von Franz does not think that the functions allude. There's a different problem. Okay, Exupery had a brother whom he was very fond, and so is his mother. His mother named everything after this brother, who died between the ages of 6 and 7. And this was a great shock to him, which he never got over. And I'll show you. Now this is sort of a clue to what's going on here. Okay, so now this is the two brothers here. You know, and the one on the right is Exupery, and the one on the left is his brother, and those are his other siblings there. You know, and he died. So that this was a great shock to Exupery, which he never got over. The child is very much mirrored in the entire story of the little prince, is kind of about his little brother. And Exupery consciously had him in mind when he wrote it. And I think that's why this is such a wonderful x-ray of the psyche, you know, because this it's like I say, it's almost like Nietzsche's Zarathustra, you know. It really describes his hidden psychological condition, whether he knew it or not. So it's almost like a dream. It is a dream. And so for him, the child who came to Earth and then left it again was associated with the trauma of the death of his brother, who he had good contact with and who died. And it probably has to do with the shock from the burnt out part of his personality had to do with the shock of losing his brother, and he didn't recover. So it says, his sensate function was destroyed. His sense of reality was destroyed. She's saying possibly was burnt out by the death of his little brother. So the a part of his infantile personality had died at the same time as the child who died in real life. And afterward, Exupery was only half a person. And so the dead little brother is a picture probably of a part of his personality a part of his masculinity, of his capacity for reaction, which died at the same time. You know, this is quite a mystery. So the little prince was thus an exterior image of what happened within himself, projection of something split off from him. He was born in 1900, died in 1944. He was just slightly older than his brother. We can go on to this a little bit. The fact that the little prince always clears the dead volcano, because one never knows, is the faint hope that his brother might be come back again. So this seems to confirm the idea that there's a basic vital weakness or destruction in the deeper layers of the psychological earth in Exupéry, which was responsible for the fact that he couldn't get over the crisis of middle life, which is normal for the, an inability which is normal for the puer eternus. So now we're moving on to, that's the first part about the volcanoes. So that is one's extinct, two are active, and then there's the feeling function, which is represented by the rose. Hi, Carlos. We're just going, we just got done with the volcanoes. Now we're gonna talk about the second aspect, which is very interesting. It's the little prince leaves the planet holding onto a flock of birds and travels through space. But he doesn't come to Earth directly, but visits six neighboring planets on which he explores. Well, this is the seven archons, the kings, the seven archons of the planets, who when you're born and you go down through them, each one of them gives you some type of either ailment or strength, you know. And then so when you come to Earth, you don't come to Earth as that soul spark. You come to Earth tainted or given gifts by the archons of the seven planets, and that's your horoscope. And so here's the six neighboring planets. First, the first one is a king who gives silly and completely ineffectual orders which nobody obeys. And to save face, he preemptively finds out what is about to happen, such as the sun is about to set, and then he orders the sun to set. And he's very clever at doing this. And so Exupéry is kind of making fun of the power complex, people who were lust for power, you know. And all these six figures of the little prince are kind of his shadow figures. It's sort of the inner possibilities of adaptation to reality for Exupéry. The second planet is the man who only wants admiration. It's a personification of vanity. The third planet is the drunkard who drinks because he is so ashamed of being a drunkard. And so he drowns his sorrow by being drunk. And fourth is the businessman who just counts his star coins all day. And the fifth is very interesting, a lamplighter. Well, we don't really need lamplighters anymore because we have electricity. Lamplighter would be someone who would, you know, go out on the street in Britain and light all the kerosene street lamps when it got dark. That was his job, you know, before they had electric lights. In fact, she says that they continued to pay these people for years and years, even after the electrical lights, because nobody noticed it. So anyway, he has to light the lamp at evening and put it out, extinguish it in the morning. But since his planet rotates so quickly, his lighting and his extinguishing happens once every minute. So now we'll find out why in a second. The geographer is the on the sixth planet, and he's the one who tells the little prince about the earth says he should visit it. So that now that Little Prince visiting all these planets before he goes down to Earth is very, I don't know if you've ever read the Mysterium Conjunctionis, but the peregrinations of Michael Meyer is in there, and it tells of the story of Hermes ascending the seven planets, gets to the highest level, and then he realizes, as he did in Emerald Tablets, that his strength is only perfected when he returns to the earth. So like a bodhisattva, and unlike Christ, he comes down, back down through the seven planets. And as he comes back down, he does what is called, he de-beards each one of the archons, the kings of the seven planets, takes away their power over him. And then when he gets back down to earth, he is free of the powers of fate and destiny. He's freed himself from those, you know. So that's the story of the peregrinations of Michael Meyer. But it's very, just very interesting that he should bring this in, that there's seven. So the little prince visits the number of planets before he goes down to earth. The soul, in mythological motifs, the soul is a spark which lives in heaven. And when it's born, it has to descend through the seven spheres of the planets all the way down. And during the descent from heaven to earth, the human soul acquires its horoscope from Venus, Mars, and so on, with the result that when you reach earth, each human has this specific horoscope. And on death, the soul goes back up through the seven planets. It's the opposite of what Hermes did. And then they give back the qualities they got from the archons, symbolized as their clothes that they received on the way down. So they arrive naked at the highest point and step into eternal light naked without any persona of a horoscope. So the soul had to get rid of the planetary influences. So now this is her, this is why she's called a genius. Here she's gonna tell you, what does that mean? Marlis, they call her Marlis. So she says, the soul spark is a symbol of the self, which doesn't have any astrological qualities. And the different planetary qualities are the inherited psychological and instinctual dispositions with which the human being is born. So they receive their aggressive instincts from Mars, sexual instincts from Venus, and their psychological and spiritual qualities. And it illustrates the idea that Exupery has not yet entered the just so-ness of his personality. It has this idea of his earthly disposition. He's far away. He's kept far away from his own body and his own emotional disposition. So he's kind of this one who's separated from his horoscope. And that way it was not really himself in the mundane sense of the word. He didn't possess these qualities, but spiritually he was more himself. In reality, there was something missing, but spiritually his elephants, which didn't have any psychological substance, were very powerful, but his earth were the more mundane qualities that he needed to operate in reality. His horoscope, you know, which is a symbol for the instinctual, inherited psychological and instinctual dispositions that he seemed to lack. So now he describes all of these, though, that he has here, are all different ways of adapting to the adult world, which he doesn't like. So the vain man, the drunkard, the businessman, all of them possibilities of a future grown man. And he describes them all in a mocking way. It's making fun of adult life. And so one praise to money, another praise to non-existent power, a third indulges in this quixotic lamp lighting activity, maintaining old values, which are no longer valid. And then the king represents something which he could have lived. The vain man, Exupery, was very vain, as has been confirmed by people who met him, who said he was a poseur. And he had a certain amount of self-reflecting vanity. So now he could have also taken to drink. She doesn't think he could have been a businessman. So with the exception of the lamplighter, the different planet dwellers represent ordinary possibilities of growing up, of becoming grown up in a wrong way, or an endeavor to find a pseudo style of grown up existence. So the lamplighter is most interesting, because if Exupery had followed the family tradition, he could have become a sort of this Don Quixote type of, I don't know if you saw the picture of the house he was born in. They were quite somewhat part of the higher classes in France. She says that Exupery was too sensitive and too intelligent and too much of a modern man to accept such a regressive form of life. One of his friends, Lorenda, suffered such a fate, wrote novels in praise of the old values of France, and Exupery knew him. And so for that kind of life, the pace of life, the fact that the planet rotates every once a minute, has accelerated too much and does not allow for the gentleman farmer or the noble officer ideal anymore. And such roles have become ridiculous and an illusion. So they show us how the position of the poet can't find a place in that modern man world. Now there's also the geographer. The geography tells him to come to Earth, and he can be described as the psychological function of orientation, the capacity for finding and mapping the way on Earth. So and he was a pilot and needed to know stuff about geography. So he can't pray to any of these gods. And the little prince says, that man, the lamplighter, is the only one of all of them I could have made friends with, but his planet is indeed too small. There's no room on it for two people. So, anyway, that is the, then he comes to Earth. So now we're going to go into the next part of it. And it's the seventh planet was the Earth, which has 111 kings, 7,000 geographers, 900,000 businessmen, 7,500,000 tipplers or drunkards, 311 million conceited men, and altogether 2 billion grown-ups. This was in the 30s. So the little prince, when he lands on the Earth, he's very much surprised not to see any people. This is back to the book. He's beginning, now we're gonna get into the last part, which takes up everything else. And it's really important. It's about the meaning of life and death in Exupery and in all of us, what the actual meaning of life and death is. So when the little prince arrived on Earth, he was very much surprised not to see any people and was beginning to be afraid he had come to the wrong planet. And then suddenly he sees a coil of gold, the color of moonlight, flash across the sand. Okay, there we go. And he says, Good evening, said the little prince courteously. Good evening, said the snake. What planet is this on which I've come down? This is the Earth. This is the Africa, the snake answered. Ah, so there's no people on Earth. Snake says, this is the desert. There are no people in the desert. The Earth is large. The little prince sat down and on a stone and raised his eyes towards the sky. I wonder, he said, whether the stars are set alight in heaven so that one day each of us may find his own way again. Look at my planet is right there above us, but how far away it is. It is beautiful, the snake said. What has brought you here? Well, I have been having trouble with a flower, said the little prince. Ah, said the snake. Then they were both silent. And then the little prince takes the conversation up again. Well, where are the men? It's a little lonely here in the desert. Now, here's where the snake starts getting very mysterious. It is also lonely among men, the snake said. The little prince gazed at him a long time. He says, you are a funny animal. You're no thicker than a finger. And the snake replies, but I am more powerful than the finger of a king, said the snake. And the little prince smiled, you're not very powerful. You don't even have feet. You can't even travel. And the snake says, I can carry you farther than any ship could ever take you. And then he twines himself around the little prince's ankle like a golden bracelet. Whomever I touch, said the snake, I send back to the earth from which they came. But you are innocent and true and come from a star. And the little prince makes no reply. And then the snake says, you move me to pity. You are so weak on this earth made of hard granite. The snake said, I can help you someday if you grow too homesick for your planet. I can, and then the little prince interrupts him. Oh, I understand you very well, but why do you always speak in riddles? And then here's the ominous statement. I solve them all, said the snake. And then they were both silent. The snake solves all riddles. Death solves all riddles. So the snake offers to help him in the form of a way in which to commit suicide. Now she's going to talk about suicide here, but I mean, it's really, we're talking not about suicide, but the fact of the energy of life and the fact that some people feel they're here involuntarily and aren't sure about if they buy in to the concept of life. You know, so it's just a very interesting little meditation on being alive, you know. And the snake offers him help in the form of a way and to commit suicide. And the snake says he sends people back to the earth from whence they came. And he suggests, the earth is too hard for you, little prince. And he won't be able to stand it. And the snake can help, meaning the snake can send him back to the place he came from. And the snake solves all riddles, so his death solves all problems. So the temptation that's being offered the little prince right now in the desert is death. And he offers a way. Now this is an analogy of Uxupari's life. So we're kind of talking about his puzzle and his of existence. Offers him a way to get out, an ultimate solution to insoluble problems. And the offer is quite clear. The snake would kill with his poison, which is what actually happens at the end of the book. Before that, though, we should go into a specific quality of who is the snake. And namely, as the temptation of death or the helpfulness of death, we should see what the snake represents in general. Like all animals, the snake represents an instinctive part of the psyche, a part that's removed from consciousness. And then this is what Jung said. The lower vertebrates have from earliest times been the favorite symbols of the collective psychic substratum, which is localized anatomically in the subcortical centers, the cerebellum and the spinal cord. These organs constitute the snake. So the snake is the, he says again, from earliest times, the snake is the favorite symbol of the collective psychic substratum, which is localized anatomically in the subcortical centers, the cerebellum and the spinal cord. These organs are the snake. So snake dreams usually occur, therefore, when the conscious mind is deviating from its instinctual basis. So when snake dreams occur, it is a signal that consciousness is especially far away from instinct, then you have a snake dream. But the snake dreams are even more mysterious than that. It, she'll go on, shows that the conscious attitude is not natural enough. It has an artificial quality which appears to be too well adapted and too much fascinated by outer world. Reality. So then you have a snake dream. And at the same time, the ego can't help you now, as all fairy tales and dreams tell us. The ego can't help you now. So at the same time, this well-adapted artificial personality will always fail hopelessly in decisive moments. So now, what do we need? We need a snake dream, you know. So in such a case, Jung says that there's in the snake dream there exists a sort of secret attraction to a missing inner double, the one that's not artificial. Now, which one both fears and loves as the thing that could make one whole. But then we have to give up our ego life to do it. And that's why the snake in mythology is essentially double. He arouses fear, or it arouses fear, and it brings death and poisons. It's an enemy of light, and at the same time is a savior in animal form, a symbol of the Logos and the Christ. So when it appears in its latter form, it represents the possibility of becoming whole, which is, you know, means that you have united the artificial personality with the inner personality. And this is from Rubens, you know. What they're looking at is the saving quality of nature. I mean, all these people here are egos who think that they're the king, and they're saying, no, the king is the place we came from, nature. So they may be even, you could put a picture of the spinal cord on here, you know. I mean, what they're finding so fascinating is the consciousness, the wordless wisdom of nature. So that's the saving quality. You know, that's the one that saves in fairy tales. It's the one that saves in dreams. So instead of intellectual understanding, you know, it promises knowledge that's born from a more immediate inner experience. Insight, secret wisdom, gnosis. That's what the snake offers. So you can see the snake in our story has this same double role. It offers to kill the little prince with its poison, free him from the weight of the earth, but it can also bring him a wisdom, exuperi, a wisdom that he doesn't possess. Now, the ultimate philosophical attitude of the pueri ternus, who understands it a little too early, really, is that death is not a catastrophe or a misfortune, but an escape at last from an intolerable reality. And a reality looked upon as something unimportant. The reality is unimportant, but it hampers our innermost being. Now, this is pretty much the attitude of the one who is living in an intolerable reality and wants to escape it. So now let's keep in mind, that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about this pueri ternus aspect that lives in an intolerable reality and needs some release from it. Okay. Now, it also, I think, an analogy to all of us, even if we're not pueri ternuses, about the nature of life and death. So the snake appears very often in ancient mythology. And it's combined with the motif of the child, okay? Who's speaking here? It's the little prince and the snake, you know, okay? And they are twins, okay? The example is the son of Athena, who as a little child was kept in a basket, in which one should never look, for it was a child surrounded by snakes. And it's just a mythological symbol. The child god and the snake god are often combined, you know, and you know, you can see that in several motifs. This is the burial dress of Tutankhamun, you know, and there's the snake, the child king, and the power of the snake, and he also the power of the vulture too. There, you can see, and then there's the this one here. It's another child god, who's a snake god too, you know. And then, of course, as far as the poisoner, and we're going to talk about him in depth, is Cupid and his poison arrows. You know, I mean, that is the child god Cupid, and he's a poisoner. Okay, so the child god is the archetype of the poisoner. And so Cupid had a very poisonous arrow with which he could subdue even Zeus. For if Cupid shot an arrow into Zeus, he would have to pursue without hope an earthly woman, though he may not like the situation at all. So Cupid, the child god, has the capacity to poison people. And, you know, it's just a very, this poison aspect has come up in a lot of mythology. Cupid shoots an arrow at you, and you fall in love, whether you like it or not. Depends on your reaction. If you don't like it, if you do like it, you'll be happy and say you've fallen in love. But if you don't like it, then you will say that you've been poisoned and made to do something you don't like, forced into a situation which to the ego feels like subjection or poison. So there's a secret connection between the snake and the eternal child. And by the way, with drug takers, okay, opium takers. The snake is the shadow of the little prince himself, his dark side. In a way, therefore, the snake offers to poison him. It means an integration of the shadow with the little prince. But unfortunately, the prince is not exuperi. The prince is the self. So it means that this integration of the shadow with the snake and the little prince happens in the unconscious, not in exuperi. So it moves the psychological center in exuperi even farther away from reality. So it's not very positive. It's exuperi who should have been poisoned. That would have detached him from his puer existence. So it's likely that when his little brother died, he was told that his brother was now an angel in heaven, quite happy not to live on this earth. And so he took it and realized that death was only partly a misfortune, and that possibly created in him a very detached and philosophical attitude towards life. His brother was happier in heaven than he would be here, you know, and that seemed to really strike exuperi. So the puer eternus has this mature, detached attitude towards being alive, which is normal for old people, but the puer eternus acquires this far too prematurely. The idea that life is not everything, that the other side is valued too, that life is only a part of the whole existence. And here the death temptation prevents the little prince from going right into the earth. Before he's even touched it, the snake comes in. Before he's on the earth, hasn't seen anybody, the first person he meets is the one who can send him back to his little planet, and says, if you don't like it, you know there's a way out, you know. So before he's gone down to earth, he has already had the offer of death. So, and she says she's met many people with a similarly difficult constellation. They live conditionally, which means that they secretly flirt with the idea of death. And at every step of their lives, they think they will try something or other, and if it doesn't work out, there's always death. So the puer eternus keeps his revolver in his pocket and constantly plays with the idea of escape if things get too hard. The disadvantage of this is that one is never committed to the situation as a human being and what we have at hand right now. You know, they don't go in with their whole pot. So it's this mental reservation. I will go into this, but I reserve my right as a human being to kill myself if I can't stand it anymore. This is the attitude of the puer. Go back to the womb, the bliss of the mother. I shall not go through this whole experience to the bitter end. It becomes too insufferable. Or if it does, I should just walk out of it, you know. And therefore, the person can't become whole because they cut themselves off, remain split, because transformation can only take place if one gives oneself completely to life. So she says she sees this in analysis. Everybody comes to analysis and they won't tell her their deepest secrets. They always leave something out. And she says the one who's leaving it out, who keeps something out, is either the animus or the anima. And within, they're withholding something that could be the releasing mechanism that would allow healing to occur. But healing never occurs because they of the mental reservation that they have going into it. So the analysis says, when they come in, oh, well, this is just analysis, but my life is something quite different than this. And this analytical relationship doesn't quite count either. It's different from my other relationships. So there's a secret detaching thoughts from healing. The wholeness are always in the background. And until this idea is revived through some inner process, nothing is ever real. You live with the idea that you might escape life. The possibility of total living is always lamed, for one needs to be totally involved with all this feeling. Now, this is what's represented by the little prince and the snake. All the time, I have this very uncanny impression that something's not sticking together. And she gives some examples, you know, that, let's see, of the animus and the anima. One time, some woman comes to her and she attacks her in a very horrible way. She says that this also often happens. They quit analysis, and it's either they're moving away or they don't have any money, but they're all pseudo reasons. So this one woman comes in and just attacks her in a horrible way, when the day before there was no problem at all. And von Franz would have none of it. And finally, the woman collapses and said she'd made up her mind to commit suicide. And this was just her goodbye quarrel. She wanted to kill her feeling for von Franz so then she could commit suicide peacefully, you know. So, and that came right out of the blue. And now we're going to find the difference between the snake dreams in women and the snake dreams in men. The snake dreams in men and women force them to do something that's completely out of the blue. You know, I mean, that one day they're fine, the next day they do something unbelievably drastic. And with women, it tends to be an idea. And here it's the idea of committing suicide. With men, it tends to be a mood, because it has to do with the anima, where the animus in the woman is the idea. So she thought, but there was one thing that she did do. At least her feeling function stood. Her feeling function stood between her and the idea that the snake or the animus had put in her head. The feeling function was keeping her from doing it, and so she needed to kill the feeling function by attacking von Franz and destroying their relationship. So that's why she made up her mind to be so nasty. She was constantly having dreams about an old man who was driving around on a child's red bicycle. So it represents something that's linked up with childish feeling. So her father complex, her animus figure, was linked up with childish emotion, rides around on a child's red bicycle in her dreams. And he never says anything to her. He's very detached. You know, the child's red bicycle was just going around autonomously in the back of her psyche. And she told her that there was something in her was like that. She could not get it, but she looked at me blankly. Then one day it broke through. And this is what happens when there are snake dreams. That was when what broke through is that she was going to kill herself. And then he had another man who had a snake dream, and lots of snake dreams. And just one day, within 24 hours, he divorced his wife of 15 years without any explanation. Now, this is a very snake-like, the snake indicates the capacity for cold fits in which some instinctive action can be taken that ignores the feeling function, you know. So the divorce was not wrong. It was something to be seriously considered, but it was inhuman because of this sudden cold fit. So now, the girl who wanted to commit suicide did do something more than just divorce the wife without any explanation. or at least she wanted to have a goodbye quarrel. So in her case, the feeling function remained in presence of this cold fit of the snake. So she was more related, for she did not want to just go commit suicide, but tried first to ruin our relationship. So this was really a gesture of eros and relatedness. And like someone who rings up and says, I'm going to commit suicide, but I just wanted to say goodbye. That's human. One part of her personality was still outside the snake. So what really got her was the old man on the bicycle. And that was connected with the animus in her. So the father image. If she told her, now von Franz really did believe in life after death, and she had a lot of experiences, parapsychological experiences. I told her, I thought that if she did commit suicide, her ghost would have hover over her corpse and be very sorry. It would have been motivated. Now listen, this is, von Franz is pretty straightforward here, like a lot of youngins were about this, not any morals involved in it at all. You know, she says if it's not okay to commit suicide in an emotional state, just don't do it rashly under the compulsion of emotion. That would not be a mature decision. She should think it over. And she can wait a week, let the emotion pass. And if she still really made up her mind to commit suicide, then it would, she would have done it with full consciousness. It would have been a definite decision. So that would have been more reasonable, mature, but she should not do it in the middle of an affect and then regret it later. The immaturity of the sudden decision for self-destruction is wrong. And a week's delay would not have caused her to question whether she really wanted to do it or not. So now there's just a little bit more here, and then we would start next time with the, I'm gonna turn it over for questions just a second, or comments. That many people live involuntarily and have never made up their mind about the question of life or death, whether they really they're living involuntarily. I always used to tell my mother when she got mad at me, I did not ask to be born, you know, and my father would tell me, don't say that, you know. So anyway, I don't know if the rest of it's a little bit heavy, but it's just, let's see, the difference between the animus and the anima. In the man, it's a snake mood, and in the woman, it's a snake idea, you know. And then he also brings up the fact that Exupery was an opium user, and he used it, opium and flying, to get rid of his bad moods. And so both, he says that that with drug takers, they are also flirting with death. Rather than committing suicide, let's take opium. People who take drugs seem to have a lot of snake dreams, and the poisonous snakes makes them, in their dreams, makes them poison themselves in reality, which is because they do not know or do not see how to get out of their split any other way. That alcohol is very close to that. And it's also Exupery's girlfriend that was an opium user. Her mother really liked her, but she didn't like her other, his wife that he had. He had several wives, but I think that was Consuela. Didn't like Consuela. Well, anyway, why don't we just have until Gary's, I'm going to turn it over to Gary at noon, but I've been just rattling on here. Tim, do you have any comments about anything?
Oh, I'm going to have to chew on this. It's really fascinating stuff. And I don't have any direct experience that I can think of this kind of thing, but it really helps illuminate the psyche of people who, like, I've never thought of drugs as being a flirtation with death in that regard. And I think of things like extreme sports and this attitude that arises that you see on the internet of people like filming themselves doing amazing death-defying kinds of things. And I wonder how much of that is an inability to take on life at face value, but kind of skirting the edges of it. It's quite fascinating.
Pushing it to the very limit, like this borderline. I think mountain climbers are similar to that. Carlos, did you have anything that you want to say about?
Yes, I have a question about, yeah. There is a comment about communism. Mm-hmm. Communists, poor eternos. I didn't understand that comment.
On the puer eternus, I didn't say anything about the communists. What did you
say? Yes, later in Bon France.
Oh, she talks about the communists. Yes, she does talk about that it is an infantile way of, in France in particular, that the French people after World War II were just actually anarchists, okay? But they, to express their anarchy, they all voted hard left for the Communist Party, but they didn't want that. They were the, you know, the most libertarian people in the world, you know? So what they were really voting against was the established order, you know. Now, as far as do they want Stalin and his Gulag archipelago to come to France, or what do they want mean by voting communist? I'm not sure. But, you know, what she was saying, it was an infantile response to their dissatisfaction with, on a collective level, you know, with this. I don't know. Like I say, I don't like get involved in politics, but that's what I remember her saying. I don't say yes or no on it, but she said it just happened in France after World War II. Gary, how about you? Do you have any comments?
Well, I just, you know, I find it really fascinating the role the snake plays in this, because like if you compare it to the Red Book, and there, you know, the snake provides the, you know, Hermes, the conduit to, you know, to the unconscious. And yet here it seems quite, you know, in contrast to that. Do you have any comments on that?
On the snake, well, remember we're talking about Exuperi's snake, and remember it has two qualities. One is where you saw in Rubens' painting where they are seemingly thinking that the saving thing is not intellectual. It is that they're actually looking at the one that when they're looking at that Rubens painting, and this would be closer to the spirit of the Red Book. You know, the black snake in the Red Book, that they are, they're looking at what can lift the curse or cure the enchantment. They know ego can't do it. So they have somehow, psychologically, we know that there's another consciousness in us. And the animal that represents it is the snake. And that is what that's the self in us. See, they haven't really differentiated it out you know, that well, but they have gotten the glimpse in their heads that that there's a consciousness in me that's not up here. And that's what needs, I need to be in service to, you know, which is a very Jungian idea, actually. And if you see, these are all people in the fairy tale or the dream who know the ego can't help me now. And so who's going to lift me out of this hell I'm living in? And it's nature.
And another thing that Jan asked was about the Ouroboros,
yeah,
as a symbol of wholeness. She says it's also what forms the circle in Campbell's,
yes,
monomyth cycle.
Yeah, well, the Ouroboros is a, you know, there's all kinds of snake things. You know, the Ouroboros is, this is from a torque, you know, and it's a two-headed snake, but it's not really. The snake swallowing its tail, well, first of all, it represents a sacred circle, and it also represents the fact that, you know, that the head and the tail meet. When the head and the tail meet, when you have that snake up on the cross, you know, in other words, the this part and the snake are now touching each other. It's a circle, it represents a mandala, you know, and it it also represents that monomyth thing of that we, that, you know, that it is, we are circumambulating the center. You know, we just keep going around the center in a circular fashion. And so we always come back to the point we started, which Eliot mentions in Little Gidding, and we know it for the first time, you know. So that's that idea that we always are coming back to the beginning, you know, and going around like that, you know. So it's very mysterious. I mean, you know, it's also, as far as drugs are concerned, you know, and look at that, you know. You know, that's used for pharmaceutical people, you know. Miles, do you have... Go ahead, Tim. Yes.
Well, also, Jan asked about this reference to the Jesuitical reservation, the disadvantage of this.
Yes.
Never quite committed to the situation as a whole human being. There's a constant Jesuitical mental reservation. I will go into this, but I reserve my right as a human being to kill myself if I can't stand it anymore.
Yeah, the Jesuitical or the Jesuits, it would represent some type of mental reservation that's not related to nature. You know, it's of the little ego realm is going to hold out from participating in life. So it's either, there's two aspects. It's in the, let's say the male, the mother complex and the anima and the ego are not going to allow the divine child to enter the world. They're not going to allow the child to leave the womb and go out on the hero journey. They can't leave. I'm not leaving the womb. I have a mental reservation, and it's based on my Jesuitical aspect that it's based in my ego. You know, not in in accepting that positive snake aspect and leaving and going on the hero journey, you know, leaving the womb and then going out and going up and down the hills and mountains of the world with the careless and fearful of nothing, with the lion roar of illumination, you know. That's what we're supposed to be doing, you know. Not just sitting in the womb with mental reservations, you know, womb or room. Miles, do you have any comments?
Yeah, I do. I won't take too long. Maybe I won't get through all the points. So myself, I recognize that I'm a puer almost eternus, because, you know, it's taken me basically almost 60 years to understand or to learn about soul and psyche and psychology. I had no concept until recently that soul is psyche and it's what the area of psychology is about. I had some, I don't know what I thought psychology was. So now, having said that, I say almost eternus because, you know, now that I'm becoming enlightened, I can do something with this information. The next thing I just ask you is if by chance, Craig, you're thinking of ever working with the work of Wolfgang Pauli here with us. Learned that Marie-Louise von Franz was his analyst, and I think that's really fascinating.
Well, yeah, if we want to read the 30 dreams in the book Alchemy, they're fun. They're the greatest dreams ever. I mean, no one had better dreams than Wolfgang Pauli, you know. And
is that von Franz's book?
No, that's a Jung book, you know, it's called Alchemy. No, it's the one, not Alchemical Studies, the other one. I think it's called the Psychology of Alchemy.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, and that book, you know, the Psychology of Alchemy, all it really is I think 30 dreams out of about 300 that Jung and von Franz analyze for Pauli. Yeah. The famous, you know, he was haunted his whole life by the number 137. And Jung and him kind of broke off at the end there. And when he goes into, when he's going to die, he goes into his hospital room and it's number 137. You know, so that's what his biography is called, is 137. You know, but anyway, thank you, Miles. We will definitely look at Wolfgang Pauli. Go ahead. Jordy, do you have anything? I was just going to call on Charles, but I think you turned your... Go ahead.
Well, I have to say hello and thank you.
Yes.
I just came out from a four-day Tibetan Buddhist retreat on Zoom, which finished at, 45 minutes after this started.
Oh, wow.
So thank you. I am not only vegetarian, but a vegetable myself.
Well, that's...
I am a human with a soul of broccoli or something.
Well, yeah. If as long as you can keep your protein up.
I do, of course. Okay. Now, I all look to that because this is becoming more and more interesting.
It is. We're not even into the good parts yet, I don't think.
Now, I will stay 5 more minutes also because I have plenty to do and tomorrow is back to work.
Okay.
Now, at what time do you begin now?
So I can get, you know, some of this material is so dense. I usually try to start about 10:45 Chicago time, just so we can get a full hour, then have some discussion.
Yeah.
And but the first 15 minutes are not mandatory. We're just introducing.
No.
Yeah. But that way we can get, and then I have a little discussion, and then turn it over to Gary.
So, all to everyone, I am beginning to consider friends.
Thank
or
you.
members of my lodge or my sangha in Buddhist terms, comrades or in a way, and I'll try to contribute. Okay, and see you next Sunday.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jordy. Charles, do you have any comments? Charles.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, I can't really say anything better than Von Franz has already said. This book was really, this is what kind of really got me into Jungian psychology, because reading it was like reading a book written by someone that had been stalking me my whole life and knew everything about me. Frighteningly accurate. And yeah, I can just attest to everything in here. Von Franz was, total genius. That's all I really have to say. Just read the book. All of it's true. All of it's 100% accurate.
Yeah, there's one thing that she said, and I forgot to read it, but it was about the, that the mother complex puts a sheet of plastic between us and reality. And you just note it, and Charles, in a lot of your dreams, you've got plastic over your hands or something. You know?
There's been things where like there's a plastic wrap over me and my skin, or there's plastic wrap over the floor, which is made out of flesh, other things like that.
Just a strange substance that separates us from reality. It's as if, you know, in a dream I had about my mother after she died, is there's a window between me and her, this tree that represented. So it's as if it's a pane of glass has come between me and reality, you know. So anyway, that's pretty good. Now, just Angel or Elizabeth, do you have any comments? Then I'm going to turn it over to Gary. Elizabeth, if I don't know if you've already done so, but if you want to put your email in the chat, then we can put you on the mailing list. But otherwise, unless anyone has any comments, I'm turning it over to you, Gary. So thank you, everybody. And next time we'll finish lecture 4 and start on lecture 5. Thank you.
I think maybe we're getting some crosstalk on Jordy. Maybe you might mute your microphone. Okay, we're good. With this one, I'm going to do something a little different today. With the discussion of death and the snakes and the whole essence of this, I thought it would be interesting to maybe look at doing a tantric type of exercise. And let's see if I can find it. So this is Kali. And the exercise that I've got in mind today is one that you might do if you were like a devotee. And the idea behind the tantric exercises is you'll meditate on a particular deity in order to activate the qualities of that deity in your own psyche. As you get better at this, you know, you start to feel the subtle energy within you. And I think, you know, Craig could probably speak to this as well, because when his active imaginations are becoming more and more real and they're having more and more of a felt sense. And I think the most important part of any practice we do is to keep looking for its subtle essence. Every technique that we try has a unique feeling tone. So what I'm going to do on today's is first, you know, Kali is a symbol. And so, I found a little piece here which describes you know, what the various parts of Kali represent. So we're going to go through that. Then I'm going to take us through, you know, a very quick relaxation. And then we're going to do a visualization of Kali manifesting as a storm. And because Kali is both, you know, she seems to be the quintessential deity for both destruction and creation, for attachment and, you know, freeing yourself from attachment. So visualizing her as a destructive storm would certainly be one way of feeling her essence, that, you know, that she might manifest. And this kind of goes along with, you know, like the psychology of Hillman, where, you know, we try to personify everything. You know, we try to see everything as like, you know, as a metaphor, as if. So let's see. So for Kali as a symbol, the hands on her apron represent the karmic tendencies she removes from her devotees. So you can see all these hands that have been basically amputated. The skull on her hands, which her sword has just lopped off, is the ego that separates us from her. Kali's nakedness shows that she has cast away illusion. In her, the entire truth about life and death is revealed. Even her color is esoteric. Kali's dark colors stand for the ultimate void state where all differences dissolve into the absolute beyond all form. Her sword is the force that slices through delusion, ignorance, false hope, and lies. Her position on top of Shiva reveals that she is the dynamic force in the universe, the power that churns the stillness of the void so that worlds can be created inside that transcendent nothingness. In fact, Kali holds both these energies, the spiritual liberating and the fearsome, which is why she always remains wildly, dynamically paradoxical. She is multifaceted and multi-layered, both as an inner force, a spiritual and psychological power, and as a force in the universe. So let me take you through a quick relaxation. So get comfortable. And then after we've done just this short piece, while you're in as meditative and as relaxed state as you can get in, I'm going to read to you a visualization of Kali as a storm. And like if we were doing Kundalini, you know, you would do like these breath exercises, and then you would stop and you would feel, you would try to feel like these energies within, the subtle part of it, not like the feelings of your muscles, but rather the subtle energies. And so go ahead and kill your videos, and I'll start with the meditation, and then we'll do the visualization. So slowly allow yourself to move into stillness. And as you move into stillness, become aware of sound. Notice the furthest sound away from you, the most distant sound you can hear. So just allow your awareness of sound to move closer and closer and closer, so that the only sounds you hear are the sounds in the room in which you were sitting. Just feel the sound of your own breath. Begin to hear the sound of your heart beating. Just listen to your own heart beating. Now let go of all the sounds and just let all the sounds of the environment be there. You in the center of the circle and all the sounds in the circumference of the circle. Notice the flow of the breath as it moves in through the nostrils and out through the nostrils. Become aware there is life force, there is prana on the breath. Sense and see that prana is light, moving, riding on the breath all the way through both nostrils to the third eye point. And from the third eye point back through both nostrils. So you begin to feel a sense or see two streams of light. Light moving all the way through the nostrils up to the third eye, and from the third eye back out through both nostrils. So you are drawing an inverted V of light with the breath. Now do that 9 more times, drawing an inverted V of light into the third eye and from the third eye back out through the nostrils. Now imagine that you have become Kali, and that you are manifesting yourself as a storm. Imagine you are no longer who you were before. to the void that is your home. Black nothingness from which all creation spawns. You feel the release of the aspect demonstrated. You feel the aliveness of which you were a part, of the storm of which you were. Storm ends, the sun breaks through, the seas calm, the winds die. You feel yourself coming back. You take some deep breaths. We're back in the room. Of which you felt when you experienced some of Kali's essence. And now you can come back and open your eyes.
That was quite a trip. It's very, actually very relaxing. I mean, everything you said came true. The seas and the light.
Your powers of visualization, I can just imagine at this point, are just incredible, you know?
I just feel it, you know. At first I felt I was walking in a mineral. It was just, I'm not that great at it, actually. I'm just... You know, I really, your guided meditation really works for me. Anybody else have comments? Any other comments about the anything or what do you think, Gary? Whatever you want to do.
Yeah, me too. The visualization was such a creative excursion for me. I just, Gary, I really appreciate how you can get us down into that level where the where somehow you just have this capacity to bring us into that space where it all opens up, and your voice is very compelling in that regard. So thank you. It's a great thing.
You're welcome. never quite sure how these things hit people, you know. But, you know, I think it's interesting, though, because the tantric traditions, they're very young-like, you know, it's, and it has, you know, it has an advantage, because I think, you know, that in a lot of the young groups, people get caught up in the, you know, in the intellectual approach, whereas some of the, you know, the tantric traditions, they're all about feeling the energies, the felt sense, the personification of the deities, which you then dialogue with. And in that dialoguing, you know, this is like, you know, that's like having at it with a therapist. And then the whole idea behind it, which is so different than, you know, the Christian approach, is that by, you know, meditating and absorbing their aspects, you know, their essences, you know, you become that yourself. And that's kind of their way to, you know, transcendence. And I'm like, wow. I mean, it just seems like, to me, it seems like a really good approach.
Did you have something to say, Miles? Do you want to?
Yeah, I really enjoyed that. Curiously, talking about the storm initially took me back to a trip that I did some years ago with the family down into the United States. I live in Calgary, Canada, and we have friends in a place called Bighorn near Sheridan, Wyoming. And curiously, the one day we were going from Yellowstone National Park over to Bighorn, and I thought, oh, it's not that far. We can get there easily in a day. And we drove through Cody, Wyoming, and it's a very surreal landscape of tumbleweeds, and it was a weird atmospheric day. A very lonely stretch of highway and a lot of big gray roiling clouds. It wasn't a storm, but it was threatening storm. And, you know, eventually late at night, we're driving over a place called the Bighorn. It's an area of different mountains, and it's beautiful country. And then indeed it did become storming, and it became rain, and we finally got to our friends well after. It must have been 1 a.m. But just like snakes are given a bad rap in Christianity, I think because of the story of Genesis, and snake is supposedly the one responsible for the downfall of everybody. But it's really a serpent. It's not necessarily a snake, but snakes are good. And indigenous people have a very positive view of snakes. And rattlesnakes, for example, they actually don't want to bite you. That's why they rattle. You know, they're telling you, please go away. If you're not going to be stupid, well, I'll get you. And then I then moved into thinking of another area that we sometimes visit not too far from here, in what is called the Badlands of Alberta. And a lot of dinosaur bones have been dug up over the last 150 years down there, all sorts of different dinosaurs. But one of the good things about storms, and I can't actually recall how it all works, but in this provincial park, Dinosaur Provincial Park, there are these massive cottonwood trees that, you know, take three people holding arms to get their arms around these big cottonwood trees that are 300 years old. And somehow, I forget how it works, but it does require periodic flooding to maintain this ecosystem of these massive old cottonwood trees. So that was my journey. Thank you very much.
Great.
Yeah, well, thank you, Miles. And as Carlos was saying, Kali is a very powerful God, but I think it's a good exercise to hear the thousand lunatics and banshees. I mean, and then coming down in, I mean, it's bring that into our psyche as participating in life, you know. So, well, anyway, well, thank you, Gary, and thank you, everybody, and we'll see you next Sunday, hopefully. Thank you, Miles and Elizabeth and Angel and Carlos and Gary. We'll see you next time.